Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Shruti Rajendra Shirke. I am a neurophysiotherapist and aquatic therapy specialist at Neurogen Brain and Spine Institute. I'm really honored to have a discussion on cerebellar ataxia, gaining control through land and water-based rehabilitation on the day of International Ataxia Day. So let's have a look what is ataxia. Ataxia is basically a dysfunction of cerebellum, and it is a triad that involves balance, incoordination of skilled movements, tonal and postural disturbances. It is progressive in nature. So this is cerebellum, and it is also known as small brain by a layman person, and it is located at the base of the brain, and it is a hind part of the brain. Cerebellum is further classified into anatomical classification and physiological classification. Anatomical classification is based on structure, which further has three lobes, that is anterior lobe, posterior lobe, and flocculonodular lobe. And it is also based on functional classification, that is physiological classification. It includes spinocerebellum, cerebrocerebellum, and vestibulocerebellum. So if the spinocerebellum is affected, it causes imbalance and impaired eye movements. If cerebrocerebellum is affected, then it causes truncal ataxia and difficulty in walking. If vestibulocerebellum is affected, it causes incoordination and incoordination of planned movements and intentional tremors. So let's have a look on topographical representation. So the center part of the cerebellum is known as vermis. The area colored with green color, and it controls axial musculature, that is shoulder, trunk, and hip. If damage to this area, it causes truncal ataxia. And the outer part of the cerebellum, with the area which is colored by orange, it is known as intermediate zone. It controls extremities, that is hands and feet. If this area gets damaged, then there are intentional tremors and incoordination of the hands and feet. Let's have a look on classification of ataxia, which includes cerebellar ataxia, hereditary ataxia, and other types of ataxia. Hereditary ataxia is further classified into autosomal dominant ataxia and autosomal recessive ataxia. So autosomal dominant ataxia is further classified into spinocerebellar ataxia, and autosomal recessive ataxia is further classified into Friedreich's ataxia, ataxia telangiectasia, and congenital cerebellar ataxia. Other types of ataxia include sensory ataxia, vestibular ataxia, and multisystem atrophy cerebellar type. So let's have a look on signs and symptoms of cerebellar ataxia. It includes asthenia, that is generalized weakness, delayed reaction time, dyschronometria, which is inaccuracy to estimate the amount of time passed, dysarthria, poor articulation of the words while speaking, dysphagia, difficulty in swallowing, dysmetria, that is past pointing of the movements, dysdiadochokinesia, is incoordination of the rapid or alternating hand movements. Tremors is it includes intentional tremors and resting tremors. The tremors that occur at rest is resting tremors, and intentional tremors, tremors that occur while performing the movements. There is difficulty in eye movements, imbalance, and ataxic respiration, which includes increased work of breathing and increased breathlessness. And there is head and neck titubations, that is oscillatory movements of the head and neck. These are the signs and symptoms of the cerebellar ataxia in images, which I just mentioned in the previous slide. So let's have a look on sensory ataxia. It is caused due to loss of proprioception. What is proprioception? It is a person's ability to have sense of joint position. It causes postural instability. It has positive rhombus test. What is rhombus test? The patient standing with feet together, upright posture, and with eyes closed. If the body weight increases in this position, then it is to be considered as positive rhombus test. It also has unsteady stomping gait. Stomping is this. Let's have a look on vestibular ataxia. It is due to dysfunction of the vestibular system. It has prominent vertigo, nausea and vomiting, and disequilibrium. What is disequilibrium? It is imbalance. That is, can you see the image shown above? This is the normal footsteps of the person, and this is the footsteps of the ataxic person. The distance between the one foot and the other foot is widened. That is wide base of support. And the patient also complains of feeling of giddiness while walking. So let's have a look on spinocerebellar ataxia. It is hereditary. It is classified under autosomal dominant ataxia. It is progressive in nature and it is degenerative. And it's classified with type 1 to 29 and 35. Its signs and symptoms includes incoordination of gait, hand and eye movements. And there is speech disturbances also included in this. So let's have a look on Friedreich's ataxia. It is named after German physician Nicholas Friedrich, first described in 1860s. It is classified under autosomal recessive ataxia and it is rapidly progressive in nature. It has onset between 5 and 15 years of age. The signs and symptoms includes difficulty in walking, sensory loss in arms and legs, impaired speech, loss of proprioception and vibratory sensations, muscle weakness in arms and legs, nystagmus, that is incoordination of the eye movements side to side and up and down, and fast saccadic eye movements, loss of coordination, vision and hearing impairment. So now let's have a look on ataxia telangiectasia. It is also known as loose bars syndrome, neurodegenerative disorder, and it is classified under autosomal recessive disease. The signs and symptoms include poor coordination, small dilated blood vessels in eyes, that is spider web appearance in the eyes. Can you see in the sclera? Then difficulty in movements, oculomotor apraxia, that is absence or defect of controlled, voluntary and purposeful eye movement. It also weakens the immune system that causes infection. So let's summarize about all the types, how to differentiate between the types depending on the age of onset and their key points. Cerebellar ataxia, it can be seen in any age and includes incoordination, gait and speech disturbances. Spinocerebellar ataxia, it is seen above 18 years of age and it includes incoordination, gait and speech disturbances. Friedreich's ataxia, it is seen between 5 and 15 years of age and it has sensory loss and muscle weakness. Sensory ataxia, it can be seen in any age. It is caused due to loss of proprioception and positive Romberg sign. Vestibular ataxia, it can be seen in any age and it is mainly due to imbalance. Ataxia telangiectasia, it occurs below 15 to 18 years of age and there is spider web appearance in the eyes. So let's have a look on the causes. Acquired, that is non-genetic ataxia, genetic feature, a health condition that leads to nerve damage such as stroke or multiple sclerosis, vitamin B12 deficiency and immunological problem. The MRI scan of the patients with ataxia. So this is the side view of the MRI scan and this is the cerebellum of a normal person. And this is the cerebellum of the ataxic patient. So can you see the normal cerebellum and the shrinkage of the cerebellum in ataxic patients? So this is the side view. Let's have a view of, let's have a top view of the cerebellum. So this is the normal cerebellum in, from the top view. And this is the shrinkage of the cerebellum in the ataxic patients from the top view. The management of the ataxia, it has a multidisciplinary approach in the management of ataxia, which includes vitamin supplements, avoid feeling tired to reduce it from sleep, to avoid alcohol, to avoid medications that have side effects of cerebellar function and rehabilitation. So the signs and symptoms that I mentioned in the previous slides we do a neurological assessment on based on those. It includes tone, balance, coordination, gait, posture, functional independence, speech, fine motor activities, swallowing, vision, hearing, bladder and bowel, and cognitive assessment. So the neuro rehab team includes aquatic therapy, physiotherapy, occupational therapy, speech and swallowing therapy, nutrition, and psychological counseling. So the physiotherapy includes bed mobility activities, strengthening of core and extremities, coordination activities, balance exercises in sitting and standing, gait training, that is training in walking while walking, stair climbing, visual rehabilitation, respiratory exercises, and bladder exercises. So detailed discussion, let's have a detailed discussion about the bed mobility activities, which includes turning and rolling, supine to sit, sitting with cross-legged, sitting forward, backward and sideways, shifting forward, backward and sideways, prone on forearm and hand, quadruped, quadruped with leg extension, quadruped with arm and leg extension, crawling forward and backward, kneeling sit to stand, kneel standing, kneeling overhead activities, kneel walking forward, backward and sideways, and half kneeling. So let's have a look on the images for turning and rolling. Here the patient is lying on flat back and the therapist guides the patient with hand holding, and there is a visual feedback given to the patient by giving a target or a goal in front of the patient. So the patient has a target to touch the goal or take the mobile in his hand. With the therapist is guiding the patient to achieve the goal by reaching for the object and also turning and rolling by scapular elevation using PNF technique. So this is how the turning and rolling is achieved in the patients. And bridging exercise. So patient is lying flat on the back with the knees bent. So patient is asked to lift the buttocks up and hold it for 10 seconds. This exercise can be progressed further to make it difficult for the patient with by bending one knee and keeping one leg straight and raise it up, and by raising the buttocks up and holding it for 10 seconds. This improves the lower back. This improves the strength. This improves the strength of the lower back muscles, hip extensor muscles, and quadriceps muscles. It is mainly used for truncal ataxia. Now let's have a look on supine to sit. The first image shows the patient is lying on the back, and then he tries to lift his head and neck up, and then he tries to weight bear on both the elbows, then weight shifting to one elbow and trying to make the other elbow straight. Then again weight shifting to the straightened elbow and trying to straighten the bent elbow and come into sitting posture. So the shifting forward in bed. This helps to improve transfers of the shifting in bed. The patient weight bears on both the hands and tries to bottom shuffle or tries to lift the buttocks up and move forward. Backward in bed is similar to the similarly, but the patient weight bears on the hands and move backward to achieve backward shifting. Push-ups in prones. Prone on forearm and hand. The patient lies on tummy with the arms kept besides the trunk, and patient tries to push with the hands and come into extended position, that is the arms are straightened and the back is arched. This helps to strengthen the scapular muscles, back extensor muscles and the elbow extensors. Now quadruped with arm and leg extension. So patient is asked to come into crawling position, and then we can ask the patient to kick behind or hold or raise the leg behind and hold it for 10 seconds. This exercise can be progressed further to have arm raised in air with leg raised in air and to hold the position like Superman position for 10 seconds. This strengthens the core muscles as well as the hip extensor muscles on the leg raised. So we can progress this exercise using the weight cuffs, which becomes difficult for the patient to have to maintain the balance. And it also improves the truncal control of the patient. So crawling forward, here the patient is trying, shifts the weight to one leg, one knee, and tries to take the knee forward, the leading knee, and crawls forward. Crawling backward, here the patient shifts the weight on the other knee and tries to take the knee behind and achieve the backward crawling. Kneel sit to stand and kneel standing. Here the patient sits on knees, that's kneel sitting, and tries to achieve kneel standing by shifting the weight forward, and this improves the truncal control and the graded control of the pelvis over trunk. Kneeling with overhead activities. Here the patient should have better truncal control. So if there is a truncal stability at the trunk, then only there could be mobility at the extremities. overhead activities with ball catching and throwing. In this ataxic patients, there is delayed reaction time. So we have to make them train with ball catching and throwing to improve coordination, eye-hand coordination, visual guided movements, and also to improve the truncal control. Kneel walking forward and sideways. The first, the patient is trained in the parallel bar for the weight shifts sidewards and weight shifts forward. Then kneel walking forward with support and with appropriate weight shifting. So here the therapist guides the patient to shift the weight to one knee and then take the knee other knee forward. So this is how the kneel walking is achieved while training the patient for the weight shifting. Here also to it also helps to strengthen the hip iliacus, hip flexors, and hip abductor muscles. While the if the patient is trying to achieve kneel backward walking, then also it strengthens the hip extensor muscles. So kneel walking without support, once kneel walking with support is achieved, the patient, we can put the patient in kneel standing and ask the patient to do kneel walking with supervision of the therapist. Half kneeling, the patient is in kneel standing position, and we can ask the patient to take the leg forward and keep it in front to have near half kneeling position. This position, it becomes difficult for the ataxic patient to achieve because of the imbalance. Getting up from floor. In the first image, we can see the patient is sitting with the cross leg sitting, and then the patient comes on kneeling position and then half kneeling position I described in the previous slide. And then patient takes support and achieves standing position. Strengthening of core and extremities. It includes upper extremity strengthening, trunk strengthening. For trunk strengthening, it includes upper abdominal strengthening, lower abdominal strengthening, back extensor strengthening. Then hip musculature strengthening, it includes hip flexors, hip extensors, and hip abductor strengthening. So the upper extremity strengthening includes the patient lying on the tummy and the hand outside of the bed, and we ask the patient to lift the hand up so as to strengthen the postural muscle in order to have erect posture in sitting and standing. Then elbow, shoulder, and scapular muscle strengthening. In first two images, we can see strengthening of the shoulder extensors, scapular muscles, and elbow muscles. In the last two images, we can see strengthening of the shoulder flexors and elbow extensors. Then upper abdominal strengthening. In this, the patient is lying flat on the back. Therapist is supporting the patient at the knees and at the back. The patient is given command of lifting his head and neck up and look at towards his feet and get up into sitting position. So this is the goal-oriented exercise. The patient is given a goal of watching his feet and coming up with arms across the chest. So this is to strengthen the upper abdominals of the patient. So lower abdominal strengthening, patient lying flat on the back with knees straight, and patient then tries to lift both the legs together up together. But while doing so, patient has to remember they have to press the back down either on the by keeping the towel roll underneath the back or keeping the hands behind the back and pressing it down. If this the second image, if this exercise in the second image is difficult for the patient can bend both the knees and take it towards the chest while pressing the back down. So back extensor strengthening. So it includes like strengthening with grade 4. The patient is lying on the tummy with his half upper body out of the bed, and therapist stabilizing the patient. Patient is clasping the head, hands on the head, and coming up. This strengthens the back extensor muscles in strengthening with grade 5. Similarly, hip muscle strengthening. It includes hip flexor strengthening. Patient lying straight and lifting one leg up with or without weight cuffs. Then hip abductor strengthening, patient lying on sideline and raising the leg up with knees straightened. Then there's hip extensor strengthening, patient lying on tummy and lifting the whole leg up with knee extended or straightened. Strengthening of extremity using PNF exercises. This is the pattern to help in walking. The patient is asked to pull the knee towards the opposite shoulder. So here also the goal is given to the patient. A visual feedback is given, a command is given to follow and so as the patient can follow the therapist and do desired movement. So once the knee reaches the opposite shoulder, the patient has to push onto the feet towards down. So this is a pattern while walking, when you raise the leg up and then when you push it down. Sitting posture and balance training. It includes sitting posture training, static sitting balance training with feet supported, dynamic sitting balance training with reaching out for objects overhead, and with pivot turns and overhead activity. Pivot turns is like trunk rotations. So sitting posture, it is like correction. This image shows the correction of the slouched or the stooped posture using PNF technique. Here the patient is in slouched posture. The therapist here gives commands and the assistance or a touch feedback for the patient to come into straight erect posture. Sitting with feet supported. Here the patient is sitting without the feet supported. And so as we can see, without the feet support, the patient goes into slouched posture or the stooped posture. So sitting with feet supported assists in activating the postural muscles to obtain straight and upright posture. So sitting with reaching out for objects overhead. Here the patient is trying to raise the arms overhead, but she is into a guarded posture to attain stability at the trunk. So if, like as mentioned in the previous slide, if the patient is well seated with well supported at the feet, and then to give a visual cue or a visual feedback with the goal oriented exercises, then patient can reach for overhead activity, and this is to maintain stability at the trunk. And approximation, that is compression, is given at the joint line, is applied at the end of the movement to achieve the proprioceptive impulses in the trunk and at the lower extremities or the legs. Here we can see the patient is sitting upright with feet supported and trying to reach for an object or a ball. And this also improves the visual guided movement. It's eye-hand coordination, that is, and improves truncal control. Sitting with pivot turns and overhead activity. So here the patient tries to take the ball from the therapist and rotates the trunk while feet supported, and tries to maintain the balance while doing the activity. So this improves truncal control, visual guided movement, and coordination of the hands and visual fixation of the movement while the movement. Sit to stand activity in parallel bar, then with the gutter. If the patient has poor truncal control, from same level, that's chair, from lower level and higher level. So sit to stand in parallel bar using PNF technique. Here the patient is seated in the chair while the therapist guides the patient at the pelvis and lift and ask, gives command to the patient to lift his buttocks up and come into standing position. Here the patient, it helps the patient to have better quadriceps control and dorsiflexor control, as the this leg is sliding over the ankle. Sit to stand in patients with poor truncal control. The patients with poor truncal control is supported with the gutter walker, and here the therapist is trying to support at the knee to achieve standing. Sit to stand and stand to sit from chair using PNF technique. Patients while seated at, in the chair, here the patient can do independently. It just the therapist is trying to give the compression along the axial joint line to have proprioception and the weight bearing at the feet, and from standing to sitting to have a graded quadriceps control while standing and sitting. Sit to stand and stand to sit from chair independently. The patient is seated, and then trunk forward, knees bend, knees making into coming into straightened position, and then achieve standing. From standing, again trunk forward, knees bend, and the patient can sit down. Sit to stand and stand to sit from lower level, as again the same process, but in this the patient needs a very good quadriceps control while performing this. Standing posture and balance training. Static standing balance training in parallel bar with gutter walker, and dynamic standing training, standing balance reach outs with using gutter walker, overhead activity using PNF technique, standing with overhead activity and pivot turn, standing balance training on balance board, standing with feet together, and standing with functional activity. Standing posture and balance training using PNF technique. Here it activates the core muscle, that the co-contraction of the core muscle takes place. Yet the therapist is trying to keep the apply the force on one shoulder from front and on the other shoulder from behind to have the co-contraction of the core muscles. Then static standing with gutter walker for the poor truncal control of the patients, and static standing without support with erect posture using PNF technique, as showed in the previous slide. Standing balance which reach outs using gutter walker. So the patient with the poor truncal control is trying to reach out with the support of the gutter walker and then coming back. Then moving on to standing on one leg. So once the patient has wide base of support, then we try to narrow the base of support, and then further to increase the difficulty level, we can train the patients from on going into one leg standing in the parallel bar, and then once the patient is confident enough or gains the truncal control and balance in standing, then we can train the patient independent in one leg standing. Then standing with feet together, as I mentioned earlier, if patient stands with a wide base of support, we have with the progression of exercises, we have to narrow the base and make the patient do all these exercises. First, the patient is standing with the feet apart, and then we further progression of the exercises includes standing with feet together. It can be further progressed with this can be with eyes open first, and then progression of the exercise can be with eyes closed. But while doing these exercises, there should be someone to supervise besides the patient. This is highly risky for the patient to have imbalance. Overhead activity in standing using PNF technique. So upper extremity pattern. This is the upper extremity pattern to achieve overhead activity with approximation at the, that is compression at the joint line at the end of the movement for better proprioception. Standing with overhead activity for reach out and pivot turns. Here again, the patient is trying to reach out for an object overhead with better truncal control, weight shift forward, and trying to take the ball and rotate the trunk and give it the object behind while shifting the weight while rotating the trunk. Standing balance training on balance board. So here we teach the patient for the weight shifting techniques and to go till the border of the base of support, that is limit of stability. And we can train the patient for this exercise by making the patient stand on the balance activity with while giving the patient a goal-oriented task to have visual feedback and to achieve standing balance. Then coordination exercises, finger-to-nose exercises, finger-to-finger exercises, bilateral coordination exercises, rapid alternative hand exercises, Frenkel's exercises in sitting, Frenkel's exercises in standing, and bouncing the ball in standing. So bilateral coordination exercises includes this. Rapid alternating hand exercises includes this. Then finger-to-finger exercises includes like the patient's complaint of past pointing of the fingers while doing the movement. So we need to train the patient with eyes closed first, and then with the eyes open first and then eyes closed. Then finger to nose exercises, similarly to improve the coordination of the hands. In hand manipulation, it becomes difficult for the patient to do manipulation with the fingers. This improves the coordination within the hand and the fingers, rotating the stick within the fingers. Frenkel's exercise. In this, the patient stands and the patient is given command to touch one ring at a time. So patient touches the ring and takes the leg behind, and again the same activity is continued. This is for the coordination of legs in standing. So bouncing the ball in standing. Here it is the progression of the exercise. Here in standing, it is kind of a dual task for the patient. Patient has to balance himself in standing. While he balancing himself in standing, he has to bounce the ball and keep bouncing the ball. So this is a progression of the exercise in standing. Then gait training, that is to improve the pattern in walking. So this is a PNF technique that that the therapist is using in the parallel bar. So patient is first guided at the pelvis, and the patient is taught how to weight shift on the other leg and to keep one leg forward. And then again, the patient is guided or taught how to shift the weight on the leading leg and then lift the behind leg and keep it forward. So this is the pattern of walking that needs to be followed while walking. Gait training to train this is the training on activation of dorsiflexor, that is muscles of the ankle while walking. So this patient directly put their feet this way. They do not land on their heel. So the normal walking pattern is this. So they do not land like land like this. They land like this. So for them to teach the proper technique of activating the ankle muscles is necessary. So to improve weight bearing while walking with hand coordination. So like we teach the walking pattern for the legs, the patient in ataxic patients to keep themselves stable, or the stability is compromised. So what they do is they keep the upper body and the arms stiff and they walk. So we need to make them, we have to train them with the leg pattern. We have to also train them for the hand pattern. Gait training with walker or rollator. So with first supervision and support, and then independently after learning the appropriate walking pattern. Then walking on balanced disc. This is the progression of the exercise. Like to make it difficult for the patient, once the patient achieves walking independently, then we can progress to this exercise. That is, a patient has to walk on the balanced disc, which is an unstable surface. Again, further, the patient has, this helps in improving the walking on uneven surface. So now let's have a look on obstacle crossing with support. So crossing over the obstacle, smaller obstacle, first initially start with, and the therapist can support the patient as it is in a straight line. Then crossing over the higher obstacle, we have increased the obstacle height so that the patient can step over and over the obstacle. Obstacle crossing without support. Here, once a patient learns how learns it independently, the patient can perform it independently. And further to increase the difficulty level, we can tie up the weight cuffs at the ankles. So training of climbing and descending on stepper using PNF. So to improve the quadriceps eccentric lengthening and strengthening the hip abductors and extensors. Here the patient is standing on the stepper, and the therapist commands the patient to keep the other leg down so that the patient achieves a knee bend position on the leg which is kept on the stepper. So this is the quadriceps lengthening activity taking place here. Then stair climbing, here the patient keeps one leg on one step and tries and shifts the weight on the leading leg and makes the knee straight and lifts the other leg and keeps it on the other step. So this is how we train the patient for stair climbing after achieving the strength or the quadriceps control and the truncal control, and then we progress it to stair climbing. So descending on stairs, as I mentioned earlier, in the parallel bar, we train the patient first, and this is to improve the quadriceps eccentric lengthening. Now, similarly, what I mentioned in the parallel bar, here also we are doing the same activity, but then exercises for eyes. So it is like the patient is fixating the eyes at the object and rotates the head on both the sides with the head movement, fixating eyes at the object with the head movement. Then eye exercises while focusing the object object while the therapist moves it near and far further. Here, eye fixation on the moving object without head movement with patch on the eye. The patient focuses on the or fixates the vision on the object and move without the head movement. When the object is moved, the eye should also be moved. Then respiratory exercises, in order to improve the breathing capacity, that is respiratory capacity, and reduce the work of breathing, and to reduce the fatigability, the spirometry exercises, deep breathing exercises should be encouraged for these patients. So bladder exercises, pelvic floor muscle exercises, as there is as this patient's complaints of urinary leakage or urgency to go and urinate. So to focus on this symptoms, we have pelvic floor muscle exercises, which includes Kegels exercises. It helps to strengthen your pelvic floor muscles, help control your urine flow, and it is one of the most effective ways of controlling incontinence without medication or surgery. Incontinence is urinary leakage. Aids used for exercises is weight cuffs, as I mentioned in all my exercises, and weighted jacket. So we're moving on to occupational therapy. What does occupational therapy includes is fine motor activities, bilateral hand coordination, functional training, which includes upper body dressing, lower body dressing, writing, pouring a glass of water, buttoning, unbuttoning of a shirt, t-shirt, standing with functional training. So fine motor activities includes beading activity shown in the images, bilateral fine motor coordination exercises as shown in the image, then making designs using mosaic magnet as shown in the image, picking up the grains with the picker as shown in the first image, and tying knot using lace as shown in the second image. Bilateral coordination exercises, putting hook, and all these exercises. Functional training, upper body dressing, that is wearing a t-shirt. First, there should be a better truncal control and truncal control and sitting balance. So if there is a stability at the trunk, then there will be mobility at the extremities. Lower body dressing, wearing a pant, again, same thing. So patient needs to first learn the weight shifting and the truncal control, then the patient can achieve wearing a lower body dressing. Then pouring water into a glass from water and writing, practicing to write. Then opening of cupboard and removing items out of it along with trunk rotation. Now speech and swallowing therapy, speech therapy, oromotor exercises, oral massages, loudness step exercise, reading aloud exercise, stretch of which each word exercise, and didacokinetic exercises. Then swallowing therapy, it includes chin tuck exercise, Shirke's exercise, Masako maneuver, mastication exercise, and pacing techniques. So the first image includes the cheek massage, that is circular in motion. The second image includes the tongue exercises, touching the inner side of the cheeks against against resistance. This strengthens the cheek and the tongue muscles. Exercises for upper and lower lips done by the therapist. Sucking exercise using straw with pursed lip. This improves the strength of the lips and also the sucking reflex. So oral massages to the cheeks and tongue using vibrator brush, that is Z-Vibe. The vibrator brush is used on the inner side of the cheeks and the outer side of the cheeks and on the tongue to improve the tongue muscles and the cheek muscles. Tongue exercises, the patient is asked to do active exercises for the trunk, taking up, down, sideways, and touching the tongue to the lip. All these exercises can be done to improve the tongue muscles. Didacokinetic exercises, it involves pronunciation of the pa. It includes the strengthening of the lips, that is pa. Then there is ta. It includes the tongue muscle exercises, that is the tongue is touching the palate, ta, and then is ka, which is the behind part of the exercises for the behind part of the mouth. Then swallowing exercises, chin tuck exercises, Shirke's exercises, and Masako exercises. So chin tuck exercises, here the patient has head forward head and neck. The patient is asked to tuck the chin in and swallow water. That is to this is to prevent aspiration or coughing or choking while drinking liquids. The Shirke's exercises, patient is lying flat on the back, and here the patient is commanded to raise the head and neck up and look at the feet and keep it down and keep the head back down. This is to be repeated for 10 times. Masako exercises, It is gulping while holding the tongue between the teeth. This is the exercise. This improves the swallowing. And psychological problems faced in ataxia is depression, affected socialization, denial, suicidal ideation, and loss of interest in life. So psychological counseling needs to be done with the family. That is family counseling, counseling sessions with the family members. Excuse me. Then personal counseling with the patient for emotional ventilation and motivation for vocational training. Then it comes aquatic therapy. Aquatic therapy includes strengthening of the abdominals, that is lower abdominals and upper abdominals, with hip knee exercises, strengthening of the back extensors, core activations using water specific therapy, WST, strengthening of upper extremity and scapular muscles. Then rotation exercises, that is transverse rotation, sagittal rotation, longitudinal rotation, and combined rotation. So this is the strengthening of the lower abdominals and hip and knee exercises. Here the patient is supported with the aqua noodle. The patient is commanded to bend the hip and knee towards the chest and make it straight. So here the aqua noodle is assisting the patient's exercise. But also we can use the aqua noodle for resistive exercises by shifting this aqua noodle from under the knee to the under the ankle, to keep it under the ankle and ask the patient to push it down on the aqua noodle. So this will be strengthening exercise for the hip extensors, quadriceps and back muscles. So strengthening of upper abdominals. Here the patient, the therapist holds the patient's pelvis and with the knees bent, and the patient lies down behind and then raises his head and chest up with arms across. Then strengthening of the abdominals. The patient pulls both the legs forward. Strengthening of the back extensors. The therapist is holding the patient in sideline position, and the patient pushes both the legs behind in order to strengthen back extensors. So here the patient is in half squatting position. Here the therapist is focusing on the activation of the ankle dorsiflexion and the co-contraction of the core muscles in half squatting position using water specific therapy, that is WST. So activation of the core muscles using water specific therapy. Here when the therapist gives commands for the to the patient, raise the hand up above the surface of the water. Here the gravity acts when the hand is raised above the surface of the water, and the truncal muscles gets activated and the postural muscles get activated. And further to progress the exercise, we can ask the patient to raise the hand further more above the surface of the water. Then strengthening of the upper extremity and scapular muscles in lying position. The patient is given the aqua dumbbell, and the therapist guides the patient to push the aqua dumbbell inside the water. And this is the resistive exercises for scapular muscles and the shoulder muscles. Strengthening of upper extremity and scapular muscles in sitting position. Here the patient is well supported from the back and head and neck. Here the patient tries to push the dumbbell down. This is the strengthening for shoulder muscles, as well as it also activates the core muscles, the postural muscles, and the hip muscles and the feet muscles while doing so. So this is one of the advantage of doing exercises in water. So it not only focuses at the one joint, it also focuses on the multi system. So here the patient is trying to push the dumbbells half into the water and make it and separate it or take it away from each other so as to strengthen the scapular muscles in half squatting position. Then transverse rotation. Here the patient is in sitting posture. The therapist commands the patient to push both the legs behind and come forward. So patient comes into a lying position, lying on tummy position, and then again the therapist commands the patient to look up with head and neck, and then pull the knees forward and achieve lying position. So here the abdominal muscles are getting strengthened, and here the back extensor muscles are getting strengthened. Then sagittal rotation for upper body. This is to strengthening exercises for the trunk's side flexors, with neck muscles and to improve the truncal control of the patient. The therapist can do it first actively and then can give resistance to the patient once the patient learns the movement, so as to further strengthen the trunk side flexors and to improve the truncal control. So sagittal rotation for the lower body, the patient first bends both the knees, hip and knees, and then the therapist asks the patient to kick with both the knees on one side, and then again pull it towards the chest and kick on the other side. This sit to stand with support. Here the patient with the poor truncal control is supported by the therapist from the squatting position to standing position. Then sit to stand with supervision. Once the patient learns the sit to stand transition, the patient can perform it independently in water. The water itself challenges the balance of the patient, so with close supervision of the therapist. So sit to stand with self-assistance, patient can do it self-assistedly. You can see in the images. So standing exercises. If the patient has poor truncal control, so patient can be supported initially the patient can be given support, and then slowly once the truncal control is achieved, the patient can stand with self-assistance. So independent standing with tubulars. Once the patient gains independent standing, the therapist can give tubulars, that is the waves, the therapist can create waves in the water so as to further challenge the standing balance of the patient. And this also can improve, if the turbulence is given on the same side, this also can improve the weight bearing on the same side of the patient. So walking, to train the patient for walking and weight shifts and lifting the leg forward, lifting the leg up and keeping it forward. Then backward walking, here the therapist supports the patient and guides the patient for weight shifting and keeping the leg, lifting the leg and keeping it backward. Then walking in straight line in water, once the patient achieves independent walking and learns the walking pattern in water, then we can also train the patient to walk in the straight line to further challenge the balance in walking. Also to improve dorsiflexion activity, or to improve the weight bearing on the feet while walking, we can use fins while walking in the water. That gives resisted exercises for the legs. So let's have a look on nutrition. The patient should be hydrated well. It should have the patient should be on high fiber diet, and they should avoid processed preserved food, avoid artificial colors used in food, avoid excess sugars and gluten free diet, such as to avoid foods containing gluten like bread, wheat and its products if allergic to gluten. Then the summary of the rehabilitation in different phases. So there is three phases, which includes early phase, intermediate phase and advanced phase. In the early phase, the patient can be independent. In intermediate phase, the patient could be partially dependent, and in advanced phase, the patient could be dependent. So in all the phases, physiotherapy is necessary. The yellow indicates the therapy is mandatory, and the orange color indicates it may or may not be required. So in early phase, the physiotherapy is mandatory. In all the three phases, physiotherapy is mandatory. And in early phase, occupational therapy may or may not be required. But in last two phases, that is independent and advanced phase, it is mandatory. For speech therapy in the early phase, it may or may not be required depending on the affection of the disturbance of the speech involved. And in the later two stages, speech therapy is mandatory. Psychological counseling is mandatory in all the three phases. Aquatic therapy is mandatory in all the three phases. Nutrition is also mandatory in all the three phases. Bladder exercise may or may not be required in the early phase, but it is mandatory in intermediate and advanced phase. Respiratory exercises, it may or may not be required in the first two phases, that is early and intermediate phase, but it is mandatory in the advanced phase. So after this also, because ataxia is a progressive condition, it still goes on progressing. So we have unmet medical needs. So none of the treatment approaches help in neuronal or axonal regeneration. So rehabilitation and assistive devices are used to improve overall functioning. However, the pathophysiology is not altered. Condition keeps progressing, as I mentioned. Hence, the treatment strategy for ataxia should focus on repairing underlying core neuropathology. So there is a ray of hope. Let's know what is regenerative medicine. Here, the process of creating living functional tissues to repair or replace tissue or organ function lost due to age, disease, damage or congenital defects using healthy tissue or stem cell transplantation. Here, where there's the damage in the brain, and the stem cells with the stem cell transplantation, it can repair. What are stem cells? Stem cells are defined as precursor cells that have the capacity to self-renew and to regenerate multiple mature cell types. Stem cells, it is unspecialized immature cells that are capable of dividing endlessly and of making exact replicas of themselves and also of spawning a range of more specialized cells. What are stem cells? The cells that have the ability to repair, replace, and regenerate, in brief. How do they do that? Long-term self-renewal, that is, one parent yields to two daughter cells identical to the parent throughout the life. So this is the parent cell, and then the daughter cells are yielded out of it. Specialization, that is, a parent cell gives rise to the daughter cells that can differentiate into specific tissue cells of similar origin and as that of the parent cells. This is the parent cell, and it gives rise to the daughter cells of the similar origin through de-differentiation and trans-differentiation. Stem cells are unspecialized cells that have the following unique properties, that is, robust repopulation of target tissue, paracrine effect, transplanted cells through paracrine signaling induce changes in nearby cells, altering the behavior of those cells and cellular microenvironment. That leads to neuroprotection, immune modulation, reduced inflammation, and neoangiogenesis. Mechanism of action of stem cell. So this is stem cell. It causes transdifferentiation, cell fusion, microvesicles, paracrine effect, and mitochondrial transform. So based on source tissue, there are embryonic stem cells, adult stem cells, umbilical cord stem cells, and induced pluripotent stem cells. Routes of administration of the stem cells are intrathecal into the CSF fluid, the lumbar junction, then intracerebral or ventricular, intranasal, then intracoronary, intramuscular, intravenous, intraarterial, and intraarticular. What are the major types of stem cells? Embryonic stem cells, adult stem cells, umbilical cord blood stem cells, and induced pluripotent stem cells. So why we choose to work with adult stem cells in the clinical setting? Because it is safe, non-tumorogenic, no rejection, early obtainable, and no ethical issues with it. Factors affecting neuronal growth and repair: it reduces neuroinflammation and stress. Neuroinflammation due to regenerative medicine and stress due to psychological rehabilitation, and it improves exercise with physiotherapy, occupational therapy, speech therapy, active aquatic therapy, and it also improves with nutrition, that is, diet and nutrition advice. Benefits of exercises in adults, that is, neuroprotection. It is the secretion of the neurotrophic factors, improves blood supply to the brain, and enhanced neuroplasticity. Thank you. If you have any questions, you can ask me. Rolling can be done, rolling should be done with the patients with truncal ataxia, but with the guided movement, and if there is a visual feedback to the patient, then of course the patient can do it in a better way, that goal oriented exercise, while and the patient can, the therapist can guide the patient to achieve rolling while having the eyes on the target that is kept in front of him to achieve rolling. This was the answer to Nikita Singh. Any further questions? So duration to achieve this achieve progress in this method is for Mirudhu Varshini. So it depends on the involvement of the signs and symptoms of the patient. So if the patient is like it is in the early phase, like I said, if it is in the early phase, then of course we can achieve this targets like within few months. But if it is furthermore, like if it is involved affected more, then it takes time. Now moving on to next question, should weights to be applied distally or proximally in ataxic patients? So what I will suggest is the weights can be applied distally or proximally. So if it is attached proximally, like I showed the weighted jacket, if it is given proximally, so it gives them truncal stability. So when can we use the weights distally is when there is a truncal stability. Then as I told, if there is truncal stability, then we can go for the mobility of the extremities. So that, at that time, when there is truncal stability, we can use the weights distally. Thank you, Ritu Ganda. Now, a question from Richa Shah. That is, can you give a reference for a patient Pataka exercises? Yeah. So for Pataka exercises, it is like didecokinetic exercise, as I mentioned, and it improves the lip tongue exercises. So it is if it is done vigorously, then it improves the articulation of the words while speaking. Thank you, Richa Shah. Then a question by Mirudhu Varshini. Can we achieve progress using hydrotherapy alone? No, it should be adjunct with aquatic, like it should be adjunct to physiotherapy as well, occupational therapy and speech therapy, because it is a multidisciplinary approach. Alone aquatic therapy won't help. Yeah, I'm not saying that it will not help at all, but yes, there will be some improvements or some changes seen. But if it is done with physiotherapy, occupational therapy, it will the progress will be much more better than with aquatic therapy alone. Thank you, Mirudhu. The question from Nikita Singh is, the life of the patient be pro by stem cells, how many years can the life of the patient be prolonged? Okay, so with stem cells, it depends on the involvement of the symptoms or the progression of the disease. If the progression is too rapid, like in Friedreich's ataxia or ataxia telangiectasia, the stem cells can only slow down the progression. Yes, and we can improve the quality of life of the patient with the neuro rehab technique, with the neuro rehabilitation. And of course, yes, we can prolong the quality of improve the lifespan of the patient after the stem cells. Thank you, Nikita Singh. Now the question from Isha Mahale, which exercises should be carried out first in ataxia, aquatic or land? It doesn't matter. If you start with aquatic, followed by land exercise, or you can start with land exercises and follow it with aquatic, it doesn't matter. But yes, definitely, like I answered before, if you can do it, adjunctive. It is aquatic therapy is an adjunctive therapy with all the other therapies. So it should go hand in hand. Like I cannot stress more on one therapy and not on other therapy. It should go hand in hand. Thank you, Isha Mahale. Which exercises? Okay. good presentation, ma'am. To add on moment on of marching in lying position. That is alternate upper and lower limb movements. Just like walking or marching on lying position would also. Thank you, Mari Muthu, for the suggestion. Then, Mirudu Varshini, the question by you is there any advanced therapy in our field, physiotherapy for incoordination recently? Yes, of course, we can use, so this, like, for the incoordination, presently I am using PNF technique. Of course, it is not advanced, but yes, PNF technique really helps, along with, I can train the patient in aquatic, in water, to have better coordination, because with the vigorous movements in the water, it improves the proprioception of the patient furthermore. Then, thank you, Mirudu. Then there is a question by Komal Patel. How much weight should be applied in weighted jackets? It depends on the 5% of the body weight. It should not be more than the 5% of the body weight. Thank you, Komal Patel. Then the question by Hafiz Muhammad Nasir. That is, can you incorporate side and backward stepping in gait training? Yes, of course, we can do that. For gait training, this is the progression of the exercise. So if once the patient learns the proper appropriate pattern of walking forward, then we can like to involve, like I said, to progress the exercise, we can involve this with dual tasking. That is, the patient can walk back. First, we train the patient to walk backward and sidewards, and with the dual task, so improve the coordination of the coordination of the extremities. So price of stem cell in India, it varies according to the hospitals. I can't really say, I can't really mention. It depends to the doctor to doctor. How many times the stem cells be injected, Karen? It again depends on the progression of the ataxia, of the disorder. It depends on how progressive the condition is. If we feel that at the first stem cells, this progression is slowed down, then we can think of, give some time for the patient to recover with the exercises. If we see any changes or deterioration in the patient, then only we take the senior doctors take a call, or we take a call to go for further stem cell procedure. A question from Maitri Samant. During the advanced stage, do we add extremity exercises along with respiratory exercises? Yes, of course. Yes, Maitri, of course. Maitri ma'am, we can always start with respiratory exercises, as this patient, because of the tremors, because of the incoordination, they already have fatigability, that is a sense of tiredness. So definitely with this extremity exercises or truncal exercises, we can start with respiratory exercises, with deep breathing exercises, and spirometry exercises. Thank you, Maitri ma'am. So question from Richa Shah ma'am. So can you explain in detail about PNF technique while sitting to standing activity? Yes, of course. So while the patient is seated in the chair or on the bed, the patient needs to be well, patient's feet should be well supported on the floor. Okay. And then the patient should, if the feet is well supported, then the patient can have the erect posture while sitting and not in slouched posture. So if I'm planning to make the patient stand, so I cannot make the patient stand from the slouched posture. So I need to achieve this sitting erect posture with the feet supported. And then with this, I can guide the patient commands. And with the commands, and then giving approximation while at the end of the movement, and ask the patient to get up in the standing position. Walking in line, is there texture also? Yeah, we can ask the patient to walk on the straight line, like if the patient is walking on land. So the line between the two tiles, we can give a visual feedback of that, or we can just draw a straight line using the chalk and then ask the patient to walk on that straight line. Thank you, Karen. Also, what are the dosage for the exercises? Yes, Hafiz sir. So it depends on, again, on the patient's ability to do the exercise. If the patients are getting too fatigued while doing the exercise, then let's keep it to start with 5 repetations at present and with the hold of 10 seconds, and then slowly progress, then increase. Once the 5 repetitions becomes easy for the patient, sustainable by the patient, then we can increase the counts to 10, and then further, like by 5 repetitions, we can increase it depending on the patient's ability. Okay, the question by the Mirudu: what are the contraindications to be considered before commencing the treatment for ataxia? So we need to see for any increased work of breathing. If the patient has any abnormal breathing pattern, we need to also have to check for the blood pressure, because in this kind, if these ataxic patients, there is a tendency to have high blood pressure, or sometimes the patients may have low blood pressure, but we have seen less rare patients with low blood pressure. And also if the patient is complaining of any giddiness, or if the patient is asymptomatic but the patient is sweating more due to exercise, and we are not making the patient do any vigorous exercise and still the patient is sweating, all these are the contraindications to just to stop the exercises or to commence the exercises for the ataxic patient. So the next question by Dr. Shweta Shirke: there are tongue positioning exercises also, like tongue spot. Rest position of tongue is also is always palate. Will you explain the exercise that suggests the tongue in between the teeth? Yes, it is known as the Masako maneuver, like to keep the tongue in between the teeth, and then gulping activity to improve the swallowing technique. I hope I have the doubt, Dr. Shweta Shirke. Then the question by Indri Banerjee, that is, cerebral ataxic patient do not have balance at all. Does they will be able to do the balancing in vocal functional activity? No, initially we need to check if the patient has truncal control, and can the patient do bed mobility activities. If the patient does not have truncal control do not have sitting balance at all, then of course we will not progress to wobble board, balancing on wobble board in standing position. First we will focus on the truncal control, to achieve truncal control in sitting or strengthening of the core muscles, and once the sitting balance is achieved, then only we can move to standing balance exercises. Thank you, Andre Banerjee. I hope I answered your question. Thank you, Karen. Then Mirudu Varshini, a question from her. Can biofeedback and robotic therapy or virtual reality help in accelerating the progression? So see, in patients with intentional tremors along with so the question from Mirudu Varshini is, can biofeedback and robotic therapy or virtual reality help in accelerating the progression? I really doubt that it will slow down the progression of the disease, because it itself is in it's a like neurodegenerative disorder. So with the therapy, we can only improve the quality of life of the patient, and also with the biofeedback and robotic therapy or virtual reality, we can improve the balance exercise, balance of the patient while in standing or sitting or in walking But I don't agree with this that it will reduce like help in. So it will not accelerate the progression at all. It will definitely help with the biofeedback and robotic therapy or virtual reality exercises. It will help in balance exercises, balancing in standing and in say walking. Then the next question is from Maithili Sawant. In patients with intentional tremors along with ataxia, how do we go about coordination exercises without exaggerating the tremors? Okay, so like I mentioned in my presentation, the patient with the intentional tremors, we can give the resisted movement with along with the pattern of the movement. Like if the patient has to go and take the object from the overhead activity, then the resistance is given throughout the range till the patient achieves the movement at the goal oriented exercise, and the therapist gives a approximation of the compression at the joint line. And this may reduce the tremors and also improve the coordination of the hand extremity. I hope I have answered the question. Thank you, Rohidas. The question from Komal Lange is, do we do the exercises on the Swiss ball for the ataxic patients for improving the tone? So in these patients, like once, like I also mentioned, like the tone is already low because it is controlled by the cerebellum. But if it is a cerebellar ataxia, but if it is spinocerebellar ataxia, of course there are chances to have spasticity. To improve the tone, I really don't believe this will help in improving the tone. But yes, for Swiss ball activities can improve in proprioception, balance training in while in sitting, to strengthening of the core muscles. Yes, of course, we can use the Swiss ball for all these exercises. The question by Nikita Singh. Can muscle hypertrophy be obtained in ataxic patients in absence of cerebellar contribution to the muscle tone? Absence of cerebellar contribution of the, to the muscle tone. So if there is like I just mentioned before, if there is no cerebellar involvement, then the muscle tone will be either normal or be increased. Then I don't think so it will be hypertrophied, but if there is spasticity, then with the we have to see for the strength training exercises whether it is increasing the spasticity. So we have to like really make them do the exercises with active exercises, and then depending on to improve the spasticity, that is like prolonged stretching exercises, all these exercises to reduce the muscle tone. Does Swiss ball training have any influence on tonal changes? Does it help to increase it? Yes, of course. Yes, I just mentioned it above. Tonal changes, as in cerebellar involvement, the tone is already reduced. So to have like if there is a control, truncal control achieved with the strengthening of core muscles, of course there will be some tonal changes seen, and we can do all these exercises on Swiss ball also, depending on the age of the patient, how you are taking the patient on the Swiss ball. It also depends based on that. So does stem cell therapy help in neuroplasticity? To some extent, yes, but in progressive condition with the therapy along with stem cell therapy and neurorehabilitation, of course we can achieve to some extent of neuroplasticity, but again it as I said, it is a progressive disorder, so it is going to progress slowly, but with a slow progression. So question by Bhagyashree Gokhale. Can a patient with cerebellar ataxia will improve with treadmill training? Yes, but only if the patient has a proper appropriate weight shifting and walking pattern, and the patient can walk independently on land, and then we can progress it up to treadmill, but with supervision and also with smaller ranges of the smaller speed at the treadmill, so as to avoid the patient losing the patient's balance while walking on the treadmill. Okay, so question from Arjun is how the treatment guidelines for treating adult and pediatric ataxic cases different. So we in adult patients we can, it's more or less similar. So we have a neurological assessment, a detailed assessment on based on the symptoms. We need to see what all symptoms they present, and depending on the involvement of the signs and symptoms, we can achieve, we can plan our protocol while doing the exercise, and we can have the changes in the adult and pediatric ataxic patients. Also, like in pediatric patients, we can take them on squeeze ball and on swing to do all these exercises, but there are limitations for the adult patients to take on squeeze ball, because it is risky for them to take on squeeze ball. Also on swing we can actually take for sitting balance exercises, but in pediatric cases all squeeze ball, swings can be used to achieve core strengthening, truncal control in sitting, also to have equilibrium, and if the patient lacks with the protective extension at the trunk, then we can also work on the pediatric patients for this. Thank you. So the prognosis is good to fair, because it is a progressive condition. With stem cells, I have seen patients to have improved changes within 6 months and 1 year, followed with neuro rehabilitation after stem cells. But without stem cells, of course, there are patients who still have fast, rapid progression. So that's the change that I have seen. Mirudu version. Thank you, Mirudu. What type of muscle strengthening exercises, isometric, concentric, and eccentric, will help in patients with ataxia? So, like I mentioned, all the three types of contraction can help the patients in ataxia. So, like I mentioned, the pattern for walking using PNF technique, it has all the three contractions in it, which is called as a combination of isotonic technique. That is a technique used in PNF. So it starts with a concentric contraction, and then when the patient is halfway through, that is in the mid range, the therapist can apply isometric contraction, and then at the end of the movement the therapist can then let the patient achieve the movement, that is the eccentric control of the movement. So in that pattern I also have mentioned, also in like descending the step, I have mentioned this for the eccentric control of the quadriceps. So patients with ataxia, they have very good concentric contraction of the quadriceps muscle, but they lack in having eccentric quadriceps control. So whenever they are descending down or whenever they are sitting down on the chair or on the lower surface, a lower level, they just drop down. So to have a control, eccentric control of the quadriceps, all these exercises will definitely help them. Thank you, Bhagyashree. There is a question by Isha Mahale. How can we give the total oriented activities? How can we give the goal oriented activities using visual feedback if the patient has nystagmus? So if the patient has nystagmus, we need to work on visual rehab. So if we work on visual rehab first with the eye exercises and then go with the visual feedback, of course, the patient will be having a visual feedback and it will along visual feedback along with the goal oriented exercises. Of course, this is going to be helpful. But for the patient with nystagmus, of course, they have the vision. There is no defect in the vision. But yes, to reduce the nystagmus, first we can start with the visual rehab exercises, that is eye exercises, and then progress to visual feedback with the goal-oriented activities. Thank you, Isha Mahale. Thank you, Dr. Shweta. The question by Shruti Kori is, does joint compression help improving gait? Yes, it does, but it depends. Like if you want to improve the proprioception, that is a sense of joint position in the patient in ataxia, so you cannot, it should be in functional position. So if the patient is lying supine and if you give compression, it is going to help him somehow, but if it would be in the functional position, it will help him more better. So while in standing position or the initiation of the gait, if the therapist can give the approximation and then initiate the movement, and after again at the end of the movement, if the approximation is given, it will improve. It will help the patient more than into a non-functional position. Thank you, Shruti Kori. Another question by Priyanka. So patients, when can we start to train the patients with ataxia in small ranges for control? Okay, if the patient here is not able to achieve longer ranges, like I showed in my presentation, if the patient is trying to reach for overhead activity and it is like in a longer range, then of course, if there is no truncal control, if there is no balance while sitting or in standing, of course, the patient will not be able to achieve this. So we need to, if the patient is complaining of imbalance while sitting or standing, we need to first work on smaller ranges with in the trunk for the truncal control. And then, of course, we can progress it up to the longer ranges and we can have better recruit or activation of the core while in smaller ranges and then increase and progress the exercise to the longer ranges. Thank you, Priyanka. And the question by Dhanashree Mode, is there any new technique for bladder training? So as I am not aware of it, but definitely I use the Kegels exercise for patients. I would like to know about if there is any new technique for bladder training. I will like to read about that further. I really am not sure about the new technique for bladder training. Thank you, Dhanashree. I'm sorry. I think I've answered all the questions. Thank you everyone for, okay. There's one more question by Maithili Saman. How do we train for fine motor activities in patients with ataxia and intentional tremors? So once the patients the patients have the more graded control in the extremities, then of course we can train them with the smaller fine motor activities. Fine motor activities like bidding technique, like I showed in my presentation, bidding activity, then hooking activity, then pinching activities. So all that will help. If you can also give it with the weight cuffs added distally, so the it will reduce the tremors while doing this activity. So this can the weight cuffs with while doing fine motor activities will help in this patients. Thank you, Maithili. Thank you, Richasha. Any further questions? Thank you everyone for watching my presentation. Thank you, Komal Lange. Thank you, Arjun. Alam. Auto.
Stop कर दो.
मैंने webcam on off किया.
मैं उधर stop कर दिया था. यहाँ भी start किया था. कर दिया ना?
Yeah. देखो stop किया ना. हे भगवान इतने सारे क्वेश्चंस कौन पूछता है
कितने अटेंडेंस हैं
पता नहीं कैसे दिख सकते हैं
इधर आए ना इसमें अटेंडेंस
कितना 34 अब तक कितने आए हैं टोटल
101 के अंदर और 34 अटेंडेंस
अच्छा मतलब पहले के
पहले कितने 18 19
ऐसा
ऐसा
ओके द वेबकैम इज ऑन Okay.